This is Warriors Outsiders with Drew and Grant, the best show on the planet.
Welcome into Warriors Outsiders, brought to you by FitAid. That is Drew Schiller. I am Grant Liffman. You just watched a horrible basketball game.
Facts. Yeah.
Oh.
Hey, I'm just glad that FitAid still is sponsoring the show.
Despite the game?
After that debacle.
I mean, I think we got some carryover from last night when things were really feeling good and the positivity. Because I really mean this. If that was the first time you were watching basketball, it's just not worth playing that sport or watching that sport.
Yeah, no, I think there probably would be more interest in soccer.
Yeah.
In the United States.
That's a good point. Now, to be fair, this is not just saying because the Warriors lost the game. You know, I think for Knicks fans, they must have, I mean, they're feeling better about it.
If they were awake.
Yeah, that's a good point.
We'll that's say. A late start
that
out there.
That is a late start New out York. There. Okay, so let's show a highlight maybe to kind of just encapsulate the night. What do you think?
Yeah. Usually when the Warriors lose and the game was not pretty, this is how we'd like to start the show.
Okay, let's just do it. Highlight number one. Check it out.
So third quarter, still a ball game.
Yeah.
The Warriors are in this. They're only down by 9 or 8 at this point in time. And Alec Burks, you know, we should have known that this game was just going to go off the rails because Alec Burks' revenge game.
Here we go.
So good defense, right? I mean, Warriors are looking like they're in a solid position. And then Burks somehow gets free throws from that. Excuse me?
I think the ref decided because it was a late shot clock that he just assumed that was a shooting motion because he had to.
Now, it was a smart play by Burks, a wily veteran, if you will, for throwing the ball, I guess, up towards the rim?
Yeah.
Kevon Looney was just like, okay, I'm just going to catch it.
I have a question for you.
I might have an answer for you.
Is there a situation you say Wiley when it's not about a veteran?
Well, if James Wiseman were to make a play that was veteran-esque, you would say, look at that Wiley play from the rookie.
Okay.
Right?
It just feels like anytime we say it, it's a Wiley veteran.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that's fair.
Sorry.
That's fair.
Moving on.
So
you can talk about these things when the game is so bad. But you're saying a great move by Burks.
I mean, it was smart play.
Sure.
But still, like, you saw the ref immediately go signal up, free throws. But, like, he should have just used a little more, I think, common sense in that play right there and just called it a foul on the ground. Now, it was only the second team foul, so it would not have been like an in-the-bonus situation like in the fourth quarter when I think the Knicks started the fourth quarter in the bonus already.
Yeah, I don't
think they just were automatically in.
You know when they say, oh, they committed 4 fouls in 55 seconds? You know, I don't think it even counts because some of them, the clock wasn't even moving when they had those fouls. So therefore, I think they just started the quarter and said, you know what, go ahead, just shoot free throws.
So obviously, we also wanted to make sure we showed a clip that included a foul because that was the theme of the game and Steve Kerr's post-game press conference. He just was ripping the Warriors for their undisciplined defense and for the fact that they are fouling teams way too much. And you know, I remember this being a theme, wasn't last year, I'm pretty sure it was the year before when the Warriors were fouling teams just relentlessly just early on in the season.
Hacking people.
Yeah.
Usually that's the thing about conditioning, but they seem like they're in really good conditioning when you start fouling people because you're just not in position and that's the only thing you can do. But it really isn't that. It is, you know, those fouls that they called to start the fourth quarter were fouls. And that's the problem, is that people can blame the refs for a little bit of this game, for sure, but not for fouls like that when they're actually fouls.
Yes, but the clip we showed, it was a foul, but it should not have been a shooting foul.
That's
so
true.
It
that's
was
true.
Just...
It was a rough game for the officiating.
Yes.
Especially...
No doubt.
Draymond Green got that first technical, so that actually put him in a position to have a weird thing happen, in which if you get another technical, you're out. That weird thing that happened should not have happened, and they called a technical that shouldn't have happened.
But I liked the first tech that he got because he was defending Steph, who attacked the basket, didn't get to the free throw line when it looked like it was a clear foul. And so Draymond wanted to set a tone right away, and then sure enough, on the Warriors' next possession, Steph got an and one.
Yeah, he
and got to the line.
Draymond was like the enforcer in hockey. You know, if you pick on the star on the hockey team, you know, the enforcer is going to come out and take care of business.
So, I mean, not only did this Warriors game not go according to plan, but you're 0-for-2 now on birthday shoutouts. First, it was your dad, who you did not wish a happy birthday to.
Now, to be fair, this is your son.
Yeah, I know, but it's on you.
Okay, my dad, your son. After, okay, who else do I need?
But I got you. Okay. Checkmate right here.
Right.
Happy birthday to Rick Welts.
Wow, that's a good one.
Warriors team president.
Rick Welts, happy birthday. Friend of the show, thank you for watching right now. Sorry about the game.
Rick and Chip.
Happy birthday to your son as well.
2 years old. They did not deserve this performance from the Warriors in this one. They didn't.
That is true. Everyone, shame on you.
Fortunately, Chip has been asleep for hours, so he didn't get to see this one.
I wish I was too.
Yeah.
Predictions, we got them wrong. I said Uber was going to have a good game. You said Pascal was going to have a good game. Actually, Pascal got close. You said 15 or more points and a three. He had 12 points. He didn't make a three. Uber got my rebounds right. But the point is, we're not going to focus on that as much.
Well, yeah.
You want to talk about Pascal? Go ahead.
A little bit. Yeah. I mean, he was on fire at the beginning of the second quarter.
He was.
He was carrying the Warriors. Mm-hmm. And then, right after Draymond got ejected, Pascal checked in. Played great defense on Julius Randle on the post and knocked the ball off of Randle's leg out of bounds. Then Pascal started the second half. And, you know, that was a discussion on Warriors Twitter.
Yeah, once Pascal started, I did realize, I forgot that Julius Randle's playing the four for them. And that would have been a very tough matchup for Andrew Wiggins or somebody to play Julius Randle at the four because Wiseman's playing Mitchell Robinson.
Yes.
So in that case, I do understand. Could it have been Kevon Looney, potentially, but they wanted to get some offense in there, Steph and Pascal.
You're not going to want to go Looney and Wiseman on the court together.
So at the end of the day, that made sense. We'll talk about it a little later, the other moves that happened in the middle of that quarter. But go on, back to Pascal.
Well, you know, there's a good quote from Eric Pascal that happened recently, but I kind of want to save it for
like a better day.
Yeah, for when the Warriors win the game. Should I just do it now?
No, forget it. We'll do it. We'll save that one.
Okay.
The New York Knicks shot 11 of 24 from three for 46%. The Warriors 9 of 38 from three for 24%.
Yeah.
A lot of that was the Knicks doing. They played really good defense. They're a committed defensive team.
Yeah.
As a very Tom Thibodeau type game in which they kind of muck it up, kind of make it, you know, take your other team out of rhythm, that the refs fed into that as well. But just in general, it was just a good team game for the Knicks. And
he had a disgusting game.
Draymond Green had 8 assists in 17 minutes.
Yeah.
He was on pace for 22 assists at one point.
But how about that he was on pace to play like 35 minutes in the game?
No, he was.
And Steve Kerr pregame talked about how Draymond just now is finally starting to get his conditioning and his legs underneath him. And that's why this is even more frustrating because, yes, you know, I was seeing some tweets about how Draymond, even though he had the 8 assists, the Warriors were -8 with him on the floor. But that's, you know, a little bit deceptive because that is mainly only because of the poor start to the game for the Warriors when they fell behind 20-12 with that starting lineup. When Draymond got ejected, the Warriors had completely stabilized the game. And it felt like they were really starting to, I'm not going to say seize momentum, but we were like, okay, I think the Warriors are going to end up prevailing.
Yeah, they were starting to get the game under control and understanding what they're doing, getting into rhythm, because they were completely out of it to start the game. The Knicks were the aggressors. It was night and day which team was playing better to start a game.
Yes.
But that has been an issue for the Warriors this season.
That starts.
You can't just overlook that because you can't always come back from deficits like this.
But they weren't down 20.
That's true, but you still started really slowly when you had a chance to just stay even. If you can stay even, you get Steph going, you get all these, you get the good momentum. But right now, they're struggling. I mean, you know how you said it's a -8 because you look at the start? It's the same way we look at stats on this season when you say, well, if you forget the first two games of the year, you know, their stats are really good. Sure, as they get going, they're looking better, but you can't keep starting like that.
No, but again, they weren't down 20 early in the second quarter. The deficit was not massive early on. Like, yes, the Knicks were on fire from three, but it still felt like, okay, the Warriors are not behind big.
Of
like, they're going to be okay.
And it's also the Knicks.
Correct. And you were saying how the Warriors, even without Draymond,
should be able to beat the New York Knicks.
Oh, they absolutely should be able to. But and they did have halftime to really try to come together and say, okay, we're not going to have Draymond. Like, let's just really try to grind this one out. And it just did not work out for them. It's almost like they allowed the frustration of Draymond getting ejected when he should not have been ejected. It almost seeped over into their aggression on the defensive end. Like, they were not disciplined, and they were trying to take their frustration out on the Knicks, but they were just overzealous.
But they're also the frustration with the refs, and then it's like building and building and compounding on itself because all of a sudden
perfect
you're getting
storm.
More fouls and blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
Yeah, bad game. All right, we're going to go to break right now. When we come back, we're going to show you a positive highlight. That's fun. And we're going to do some other stuff that is about the game, apparently.
And some stuff, you know, off the court.
Yeah, sure. Let's talk on Facebook.
Yeah, and drink some Fit Aid.
Maybe say something to our YouTube friends, all that.
That might make us feel a little better.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
Warriors Outsiders is presented by Fit Aid, the number one workout recovery drink in America. Try now and visit drinkfitaid.com.
What do we got here? We got Luis Kelly. Hello from the UK. Where in the UK are you? Because it is super. Is it 5:50 in the morning there? Right.
8 hours ahead, so 6:50.
Carry the divided by. Is it 7 right now?
Well, let's just say it's 11 p.m. and they're 8 hours ahead.
No, but
7 a.m.
Isn't part of the year 7 and part of the year 8?
Daylight savings.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how they. People over in London town do the daylight savings.
I should know. My brother
Yeah,
is
you
over
should
there.
Know.
Time in London right now is 6:50.
I win.
You win.
Yes.
Very impressive work.
Yes.
Okay. Anyway.
Either way.
Yangtan Smith is not holding back.
YTS is going in.
He's not holding back.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
What happened?
He's just saying just enough with the barking by Draymond. Just enough with it.
Oh, you guys, chill. Draymond is so unbelievably important to this team, and guess what? You got to let Draymond be Draymond. He got screwed tonight. He got screwed. It happens.
Catherine Gibson, Rick Welts is my work boyfriend. Happy birthday. Hey, Rick Welts is the man. The legend.
Her work boy? Do they work together? I'm confused.
Eliyahu, hello from Jerusalem.
Oh, that's cool.
What time is it in Jerusalem right now?
Wow, look it up. You got a computer. Are you looking
time
it up?
Time in...
He's actually going to do it.
Jerusalem.
Okay.
Let's see. Eliyahu is watching at 8:52 a.m.
That's it?
I mean,
for some reason,
sense.
I thought it was going to be later.
Well, no. Look at...
No,
you know,
I know.
If you look at London, you go down a straight line. You go
2 hours later? Okay.
Actually, I would have said 3 or 4 hours.
Yeah, thanks. We're on the same page.
England and you line it up as compared to
the Warriors
Israel.
Are out of sync, but we're not.
No, we're not. Catherine Gibson works at Chase Center.
Oh, obviously. Yeah.
You know that. That's again.
Sheesh.
Welcome back to Warriors Outsiders presented by Fit Aid.
Mm-hmm.
Drew Grant. Drew or false? This game sucked, but this was a cool sequence by Andrew Wiggins. Both of them, you could have said Drew. You could have stopped it at any point.
No, double Drew.
Double Drew.
Wow, have we ever had one of those?
Double Drew. Crazy.
That's too much of that name.
Let's just show a cool sequence.
Yeah.
All right, highlight number two.
I mean, again, the Warriors got off to not a great start in this game. But this sequence clearly shows that... Highlight number two. That the Warriors had stabilized things.
Yes.
And...
We're forgetting highlight number two.
It's totally going to appear.
It's coming.
It's coming. You're going to see Andrew Wiggins just all over the place.
Well, in 33 minutes, Andrew Wiggins had 17 points, was 6 of 13 from the field, and 9 rebounds, 2 assists, and a block. Watch this. It's going to work this time. Roll highlight number two.
You think so?
Yeah, it's going to work this time.
Okay.
Still not working.
No.
So what happens in the sequence, Drew?
All right, so... Let me think about what it was. Okay, so Andrew Wiggins playing great defense, all right? He gets a deflection, and the ball goes into the backcourt. And you're thinking, oh, it might be over and back, Warriors ball. Referees are like, uh-uh, you guys are going to hate
today.
Us tonight. Not happening. Then the Knicks come back, and they miss a shot as the shot clock expires.
Mm-hmm.
And Andrew Wiggins, the rebound just comes right to him. He deserved it playing the great defense.
That's great.
Then
great stuff.
The Warriors go the other way. And late in the shot clock, Wiggins drills a mid-range jumper to make the score 52-50. with about 3 minutes to go in the second quarter. Timeout, Knicks.
Do you really? Is this all come? Is this true?
This is double Drew. I said, double Drew.
If the highlight exists in this world,
no, it's there.
In this sequence, we're gonna have to fact check that. No, we'll check it later.
It's one button away from being pushed.
Yeah. If director Ryan hears my in the
no,
ear.
But this was almost more fun.
Yeah, it was more fun hearing you act it out.
Yeah.
Drew or false?
Well, hold on. Do we want to talk more about Wiggins or not really?
Sure. Why not?
He was, like,
he balled out the first half.
Yes,
he did. His only blemish, he missed a free throw. Unbelievable.
Yeah, and you know, I'm glad you mentioned that because he is below 70%.
Yeah, I know.
From the free throw line.
That's where we were looking. That's that 70% line.
And we, before the season, were thinking, you know, you'd like to be 75, 77. You know, his shot is a little bit of a line drive, so he doesn't, you know, have the arc, and that kind of, I think, hurts his free throw percentage at times. But that's something that, if he continues to attack the basket the way he has been, he's going to need to step up and knock down those free throws at a better percentage.
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree. But that one block he had was just tremendous.
Oh, man.
It was fantastic. It came early in the game. It felt like it was a momentum shifter.
He wants to come back on the show.
We got Molly walking around the studio. Yeah. This has been an interesting show tonight. I don't know what to make of this one. Drew or false? Speaking of don't know what to make of something.
Right.
True or false, you totally knew Nico Mannion was going to have his number called tonight.
That's false. I didn't see that one coming.
Yeah.
Did you?
Nope.
Yeah.
8 minutes. He did have 4 assists. He had 3 assists in that period.
When
he came in, he got that rebound that kind of fell into his lap at the baseline, and he pushed all the way.
Aaron Paschal got a driving dunk.
He had a couple really nice assists in
there. Oh, yeah, dish off to Wise.
It was very nice. Here's the frustration that people have with that substitution.
You mean with Mannion just
getting into the game at that point. A lot of people are clamoring, and I understand why, for a Damian Lee to get in more with that unit, et cetera. They felt like in that moment, that's your perfect opportunity to try to change things up a little bit and put someone like him in instead of Nico. Obviously, Steve Kerr was very frustrated with the game and is trying something else to get things going. But I do understand. I think in that moment, you know, if it's really about creating and just getting the ball moving, Damian can handle that. It's not like you need a pure point guard nowadays to do that. Draymond Green's not a pure point guard. He's a very good facilitator and passer. But my point is, I think in that situation, it would have first been nice to see a veteran come in that's been playing well with that group first.
I mean, I guess you could say it's feast or famine, high risk, high reward, whatever. Right. If Mannion enters the game and the Warriors go on a run, Steve Kerr looks like a genius. He pushed the right button at the right time. Mannion wasn't bad by any stretch, but the Warriors were not able to cut into the deficit.
It wasn't his fault.
No, it wasn't.
It was the team just kind of wasn't feeling it, and it didn't.
And even though the clip we showed at the beginning of the show was Nico Mannion fouling Alec Burks, and obviously Steve Kerr, I'm sure, wasn't happy about the foul.
Right.
I mean, it's his pretty much like his first major minutes. Like, it's not a big deal. We were showing that mostly because it was the officials who called it a shooting foul. But hey, we know that Steve Kerr at times is going to do stuff like this. He wanted to get Nico Mannion into a game with, you know, the outcome still very much up in the air. He wanted to let Mannion have that experience, and he showed some flashes. Nico Mannion being inserted into the game, though, did not cost the Warriors.
No,
by any stretch.
And
I know you're not saying that.
No. It was just in that moment, it was like, hey, why don't you put something? It is crazy that Damian Lee was a plus 11 16 minutes, while no one else that played over 10 minutes was even in the positive at all.
So I think the biggest upset of the night is that you did not save that for Granalytics. I thought that was ticketed.
Granalytics, I'm just going to say one thing really stupid. But
What a tease.
What a tease. But no, I find that very interesting that stat was, I don't know. I don't know if that's just a fluke, but it, at some point you see a pattern in which Damian is putting up a positive plus minus each and every night, and you go,
he didn't score.
No, he didn't. He had 5 boards.
He did have 5 rebounds. He committed 3 fouls. He was 0 for 2 from 3. He's cooled off a little bit from the 3-point line, unfortunately, the last 3-4 games after like 49% the first 10 games. He was unbelievable. Obviously, he won the Warriors a couple games. So, I mean, that right there, him being plus 11, it just weird.
Yeah.
Weirdness.
It was a weird game all around. All right, we're going to go to break right now. When we come back, we'll talk a little James Wiseman. I'll give my favorite grand.
Oh, it's going to be a good one. Don't go anywhere.
All that's coming up. In the meantime, we're going to talk on Facebook.
Perfect.
So is that highlight in there?
Should we still just show it? That'd be funny.
Who's... Is that a joke?
What's a joke? I'm not hearing anything.
Oh, okay. We'll talk after. Let's see here. Mark says back to Facebook.
Back over there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yangton Smith, can somebody tell me what the first tech was for? I missed it. I don't know if that's sarcasm, but...
We discussed. Draymond yelled at the official for not calling a foul.
For backing up. Yeah.
When Steph Curry drove to the basket and did not get to the free throw line.
Ann says, so Grant and Drew, maybe you can answer our question now.
Oh, what's the question?
Let's see. I'm trying to find it. I haven't seen the question.
Come on, Grant.
I can't find it.
What time are we off?
I'm trying to go back in time. 07:30.
All right, so we're going to have a solid 5.5.
Ann Connington-Muller says, what did Baze do for this tech? I think he was yelling at the refs for... there was a foul called. He was frustrated with the four fouls in the 55 seconds.
Baze is feisty.
He is feisty.
Like, he wears his emotions on his sleeve.
Do you know who's also underrated feisty? Brad Wanamaker.
Yeah.
He looks like a quiet, just kind of subdued guy, but he has some bite to him, that Brad. rough game for Brad tonight.
Yeah, back-to-back games. We'll save it for the show.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
They're saying, why didn't they bring Draymond back when the ref admitted it was a mistake? Because I don't think it works like that, unfortunately. Once you
send
somebody off a court, it's done.
But why can't you challenge that?
They should be able to talk to each other as refs and be like, I don't
communicate.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Welcome back to Warriors Outsiders, presented by Fit Aid, a show that will definitely not be making it into our Emmy package at any point, unless we.
Man,
really
I disagree.
Want... Yeah, you think this is the one that's going to go?
This is when true champions are born. After terrible games
we are not going to win a championship then. So, hey, Drew, Granalytics. The Warriors are 8-7. Okay.
Oh wow, we're already. This is going to be terrible.
The Warriors won their 8th game of the year last year in their 32nd game. This year, it was in their 14th game. When do you think they won their 10th game of the year?
Are you jumping from 8 to 10?
Because I thought they were going to win tonight.
I don't know. Last year sucked.
44th game. So I'm just trying to give
William
some
McCovey.
Perspective, a little perspective right here,
okay.
Saying, you know what, just remember, things are a little better. That's a glass half full that I've never done before.
Maybe you
way.
Weren't lying when you said this isn't going to make our Emmy real.
No, it's really dumb one.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
So 8-7, they're still in the thick of things in the West, of course. It's still so early in the season, but... It was a bad loss.
It was a bummer.
I think
of a loss.
I would say the Pacers one was more disappointing. This one is probably more frustrating, I think, if I'm going to...
Oh, wow. Yeah. Now we have to analyze what is the difference between disappointing and frustrating.
Break it down, baby.
This is like a disappointed father.
Yeah.
Not angry, but disappointed.
Just disappointed.
Okay.
Yeah.
Go to sleep, Chip.
James Wiseman, by the way, in 25 minutes, he had 15 points, 8 rebounds, 2 assists. It was a game in which, and we talked about this, when he makes that quick first move or he goes straight to the hoop or goes for a lob and gets it, it seems decisive and it's strong. When he has to make a decision right now to make an offensive move himself and try to drive, et cetera, he got a travel call, and B, it's just not there yet.
Yeah. No, and going against Mitchell Robinson, that's not easy.
No, that's not easy at all.
He certainly has had some tough matchups early on. It's not just, hey, you've only played 3 college games and no training camp, but go play against some of the best big men in the NBA.
There's Rudy Gobert next.
Yeah.
So what I'm thinking is, in the first part of this game, they ran a design play for him to get a 3-pointer.
Yeah.
Right? Maybe
a split action, actually.
A split action for him. So maybe They try their best in this game to bring Wiseman away from the hoop as much as possible and try to use that to their advantage and make Gobert leave the hoop as much as possible and get Wiseman out there. Maybe run, I mean,
a lot of Steph Wiseman pick and roll.
High ball screens with Wiseman up there makes the most sense in this next game.
I agree with that.
But defensively, it's tough. Rudy's underrated offensively
in
his ability to finish lobs and be in the right spot. So Wiseman's in for a challenge on that one.
The Jazz are 11-4. I actually picked them to finish third in the Western Conference in the regular season when we did our predictions with our friends' emails. We're only going to resurface those details, by the way, if they are somewhat accurate.
Oh, yeah, no. No one wants to know how
those emails will not get hacked and released. Not going to happen at all. You mentioned the two assists for Wiseman. I was really impressed with that offensive rebound he had, and boom, threw it right out to Steph. It's like a warm-up three. He stepped right into it and knocked it down. And I just mentioned Steph. We haven't really talked about him much at all. Perfect segue, the heart rate.
Yes, 30 points for him tonight.
Yep.
7 of 8 from free throw. Many people were wondering, why doesn't he just get more fouls in a game that is just so mucky to, when they're in the bonus, maybe get to the line a little bit more. But more importantly, Drew, I wished during that game I could slow my heart rate down enough that I could just ease off to sleep and not watch the rest of it. However, I'm finding out now that Steph Curry can do that within the game.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. Yeah, so ESPN's David Fleming had an article.
Dave Fleming!
Different. This one's David.
Okay, other Dave Fleming, friend of the show, hey.
Not David, by the way, because you know David.
Yeah,
Dildy.
Of course I know David.
That's his name, David Dildy.
Yeah.
Stanford basketball. Anyway, this is a takeaway from that article. Curry's second wind comes from his ability to rapidly lower his heart rate during short breaks, even in the middle of games. It's something he trains his body to do. Once he's out of breath at the end of most workouts, Curry lies on his back, and his personal trainer, Brandon Payne, places sandbag weights below his rib cage in order to overload and train Curry's diaphragm.
Woo!
Are you uncomfortable right now?
I don't know.
That doesn't feel good.
That's really cool that he's able to do that.
I mean, you don't become the only unanimous MVP in NBA history
without slowing your heart rate down.
Without having stuff jammed in your rib cage. I mean, right?
It's very impressive. It doesn't surprise me that he's able to do something like that. He always is laying on his back, and you're always wondering, like, is he just, you know, is he stretching or what is he doing? Apparently, that's what he's doing when he's laying down on his back.
He doesn't get a chance to do the lay on the back this year, though, because of the COVID protocols, right? Hasn't he been sitting in his chair mostly?
Yeah.
He hasn't really been laying down.
Are you allowed to do that? We're going to have to follow up with our friends over at Chase Center.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't have any friends.
Hey, Klay Thompson was sitting behind the bench.
That was nice to see Klay. Let's end on a positive note. There you go. Hey, everyone, thanks for joining us. I promise you the show won't be this bad again.
Disagree. It will be.
Have a wonderful night.